The Mermaid of Kafir by Evelyn Foster and Owen Whelan. Far away to the west, there is a magical underwater kingdom called Kafir, deep beneath the dark emerald sea. If you look carefully on days when the wind is still, you can sometimes see the rooftops of the town, tall steeples and bent gables and the crowns of ancient trees. And if you visit the seashore at night, you can see lights that glow like tiny jewels, and hear bells that ring out like silver. At the heart of the kingdom of Kafir stands a castle. It has turrets of pearl and sapphire, and its towers are guarded by huge seahorses with glittering manes. If you're lucky, you may also catch a glimpse of the sea folk, with their webbed bodies and their long green hair. They are strange, unearthly, and beautiful. Long ago, the kingdom of Kafir had a magnificent queen named Ariane. People said that she was lovelier by far than any mortal woman, and it was true. For Ariane was a beautiful mermaid, with skin as white as a gull's wing and a voice like the song of a harp. But her eyes were as hard as stones, and her heart was cruel. For miles around, people feared her, because Ariane stole children and dragged them beneath the waves to serve her. When she tired of them, she turned them into sea bass. One summer evening, Ariane swam to the surface of the sea and saw a mortal boy called Ewan. As soon as she saw him, she wanted him for her own. Now Ewan was a farm boy who loved to walk on the shore beside the sea when his work was finished. Every evening, he walked barefoot on the warm, white sand, and every day Ariane watched him. She swam close to the shore and talked to Ewan, tempting him with tales of her kingdom. She promised him gold, she promised him jewels, she promised to make him immortal if only he would leave the land and live with her beneath the waves. But Ewan loved the land. He loved his dog, Merlin, and most of all, he loved his sister, Megan. So he refused the offers of the beautiful mermaid, and he was silent when she mocked him. Each time Ewan refused to go with Ariane, she wanted him even more. So she bided her time beneath the cold green waves. At last, she came up with a cruel plan. The next time she saw Ewan on the beach, she sang to him of the beauty of the sunrise. The sea may look beautiful in the evening, she told him, but unless you've seen it, you cannot imagine how lovely it is at dawn. Come and see, come and see. For Ewan did not know, but Ariane knew, that there was a spell on Kafir. Every year, on the 1st of May, at sunrise, the town rose up above the water, and any mortal who saw it would be drawn by the enchantment into its streets. And when the sun was fully risen, the town disappeared, trapping them there forever. Ewan suspected nothing. Wanting to see the beauty of the sea at dawn, he woke up early the next day, which was May morning, and set out. He was astonished at the sight of the magical town, and ventured in at its gate. Ariane was ready. With a cry of greedy joy, she seized him and dragged him beneath the waves. In her castle, the mermaid gave Ewan a strange ruby wine. It tasted so sweet that Ewan drank it all, but as soon as he had swallowed it, he forgot the land. He forgot his home. He forgot his dog. And he even forgot his sister, Megan. But Megan did not forget him. Megan was brave, loyal, and true. When Ewan did not return, she cried for 7 days and seven nights, and even Merlin could not comfort her. At last, Megan dried her tears. She knew that if she wanted to rescue Ewan, she would need the help of the Sea Witch. Now the Sea Witch lived in a cave at the edge of the Western Sea. The door of the cave was guarded by three sea dogs, the cousins of dogs who live on land. Few people had met the sea dogs and lived to tell the tale. But Megan was not thinking of the sea dogs. She thought only of her brother, Ewan. Taking Merlin with her, she walked and she walked until she came at last to the entrance of the cave. When she saw the sea dogs, she did not fear them. And because she had a land dog with her and was not afraid, the sea dogs let her pass. Megan and Merlin walked a long, long way down a wet, dark tunnel and into a chamber of silver. The room blazed and sparkled with light from silver treasures of every kind, finely wrought cups and dishes, huge bowls and trophies and boxes of exquisite earrings, bracelets and necklaces. With her hand on Merlin's collar, Megan walked straight through the chamber of silver. Next, they came to a chamber of gold. Here, the treasures were even brighter than in the chamber of silver. Again, Megan walked straight through, and because she did not touch any of the treasure, she was allowed to pass in safety. Had she so much as touched one silver teaspoon, she would have been turned at once to cold stone. At last, Megan and Merlin reached a winding staircase that led to the witch's tower. Up and up and up turned the staircase, and Megan and Merlin turned with it. As they rounded the last bend, they came face to face with a dragon, and what a dragon it was. As soon as it saw them, it opened its huge jaws and belched orange fire and roared until the whole staircase shook. But Megan stood still and did not flinch, and the dragon crumbled to dust. The door of the tower flew open, and there sat the Sea Witch. She had hair as tangled as seaweed and eyes as old as the moon. Slowly, with Merlin beside her, Megan went up to the Sea Witch. The witch held up a finger and beckoned. "Come in, child," she said, "for by your courage so far, I've already decided to help you. Come and tell me your trouble." Then Megan told the Sea Witch of her brother Ewan and how he had disappeared. The Sea Witch closed her eyes and saw Ewan in the power of the mermaid. Then she looked deep into Megan's eyes and asked what she would do to save him. "He is my brother," Megan told her. "I will do anything to save him." "Would you even give up your most cherished possession?" asked the Sea Witch. "To help my brother," said Megan, "I would give up life itself." "I do not want your life," replied the Sea Witch, "but in return for my help, you must leave your dog with me." And the Sea Witch leaned forward and laid her hand on Merlin's collar. Megan shook from the soles of her feet to the roots of her hair, and her face turned pale. But Merlin walked quietly to the witch and lay at her feet. Though her heart ached, Megan knew that he would be safe with the Sea Witch, so she did not try to stop him. Now the witch knew that Megan did indeed love her brother. For a love as true and strong as this, she was prepared to share her wisdom. "Listen carefully," the Sea Witch told Megan. "There is one thing that Ariane cannot withstand, and that is the touch of iron. For iron is of the earth itself, and has the powers of the earth behind it. If you fight the mermaid with iron, you have a chance. But Ariane is dangerous, and once in her realm, you are in peril." Then the sea witch gave Megan an old iron-bladed knife. To enter the kingdom of Kafir, she said, you will have to wait another year until the first day of May. Guard this knife safely and be sure to take it with you. Then she wished Megan well and ordered her monsters to let the girl pass. Megan kept the iron-bladed knife with her every day, and every night she slept with it under her pillow. And so a year passed. Then, on the 1st of May, Megan woke early and walked to the shore before sunrise. The kingdom of Kafir rose up onto the land, and Megan stepped boldly into it. She made her way straight through the town to the mermaid's castle of pearl and sapphire. The walls were hung with tapestries and the floors were white with shells. As Megan walked, sea bass brushed against her skirts, but everything around her was silent. In the center of the castle, Megan saw Ewan. He was sitting on a lonely throne, drinking wine from a heavy goblet. "Ewan!" Megan shouted, and she ran to him, but Ewan looked straight through her. Megan was nearly in despair. Then she remembered the knife. She touched him with its blade, and at once her brother's eyes were opened and he embraced her. Then Megan touched one of the sea bass with the blade of the knife, and it turned back into a child. Quickly, she touched another, then another. Soon, the castle was ringing with children's voices, and all of them were clamoring to escape. But before they could move, the mermaid was there. She glared at the children. She glared at Megan, she glared at Ewan. Never had she looked more dangerous. Never had she looked more beautiful. As the children stood frozen, the mermaid seemed to grow. She swelled till her head touched the ceiling, and the tip of her tail touched the floor. Her hair curled around the room like a serpent's coil, and it began to wind around the children like a net. Ariane wanted to keep all the children, but most of all, she wanted to punish Megan. She stretched out a long white arm and pulled her off the floor. Megan wanted to scream, but she knew she had only seconds left. As she struggled, she struck the mermaid's wrist with the blade of the knife. Ariane gave a long, deep moan and turned into a sea bass. Then Megan, Ewan, and the children ran from the palace and up to the shore. And there, waiting for them, stood Merlin, barking with the pleasure of seeing them alive. That night, all of the children were safely restored to their families. And the next day, Megan and Ewan went with Merlin to thank the sea witch and return her knife. From then on, when they walked in the evenings on the shore by the sea, they looked very hard at the sea bass, for both of them knew that one of those shimmering fishes had once been Ariane.